Well, I'd like to thank Danielle and Ovidio for inviting me and giving the opportunity to speak. So the program for the week is I thought I would spend some time giving an introduction to optimal transportation and maybe over the course of the week highlighting some connections to economics and geometry. And then I also want to tell you about some work in progress with Brendan Pass and Pierre-André Chiappori, so Pierre-André Chiappori is an economist here at Columbia, and he's interested in studying marital matching problem, marital matching patterns. And one of his PhD students a few years ago studied matching patterns between men and women and discovered that the women have more relevant parameters than men do. And so more or less, so she's now a professor in the business school at University of Pennsylvania, but in the reduced version of her model, men are parameterized by income and women are parameterized by income and fertility. And so one of the observations is that the income of marital partners tends to correlate, so men that earn more tend to marry women that earn more, with the exception that at the very top of the market, the men that earn the most often don't marry women with high incomes, but they rather marry women who are very fertile. So age is a proxy for fertility in her data. And so she was interested in matching, in pairing problems where the men were parameterized by one dimension and the women were parameterized by two dimensions. And that's what, so Pierre-André started asking Brendan and I what we could do about optimal transportation when one space had a higher dimension than the other, and this is where it led. And I think that with the abstract that I sent to Daniela and Ovidio, I included a few references. So I have a survey paper with Nestor Guillen from 5 or 6 years ago on my webpage, and I also have a survey paper by myself. So this one appeared in DCES 2014, and this one appeared in the Proceedings of a Summer School from Montreal around 2013, I think. And then I have two preprints, one with Chiappori and Pass, and one with Ludovic Rieffert, which has to do with transportation between spaces with geometry and topology, and what can one say about uniqueness in that situation. And all of these are, you can get them off my website, www.toronto.edu/McCann. Oops. /publications. So in the optimal transportation problem, you're usually given a cost function, which you're trying to minimize, or sometimes in the context of economics, you think of a surplus, which you're trying to maximize. And you're given a distribution of producers over the surface of the countryside X and a distribution of consumers over the surface of the countryside Y. And you're asked to pair the producers with the consumers so as to minimize C or to maximize S. And so I'm going to think about the case, where the producers live on a manifold, but you could just think of it as being a subset, an open domain in Euclidean space of some dimension. And the consumers are going to live on another manifold, but it will be a lower dimensional space. So you have some distribution of production and some distribution of consumption. And I'll model this being given by measures U plus and U minus. And in the simplest case, the total production is equal to total consumption, and so you can normalize U plus and U minus to have the same mass and take it to be one. So these are Borel probability measures. And the variational problem proposed by Monge is to find some map T which takes m plus to m minus with the property that the image of mu plus under t should coincide with mu minus. So, or the push forward of mu plus through t, where push forward the plus on any set V over here is defined to be the mu plus mass of T inverse V. And so I should talk, and okay, so maybe I'll, what is the variational? Well, so let me say something about this condition. So if, oh yes, right, so there was a correction to this morning's talk, so Javier wanted to highlight this exponent here, this change of exponent. So let me say a bit more about this condition that T pushes forward mu plus to mu minus. So alternately, or equivalently, if I integrate any test function against push forward mu plus, I should get the same thing as if I integrate phi composed with t against mu plus. And I could take, let's say, it doesn't really matter, I could take continuous test functions on my target space, continuous bounded. So, for example, in the examples that we'll often be thinking about, mu plus and mu minus will be absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue measure in their ambient dimensions. And so, in that case, I will write F plus as the density of U plus with respect to Lebesgue measure. Sorry. And similarly, F minus, if U minus is absolutely continuous, it's density with respect to Lebesgue measure in its ambient dimension. And if T is, if T were Lipschitz, and dt has full rank, then the coarea formula can be used to tell you something about the differential equation that T should satisfy. So, yeah. So what is the coarea formula? In geometric measure theory, says that when you have a mapping T like this, you define its Jacobian to be, I guess, the square root of the determinant of the product of this matrix and its adjoint. Jacobian T of X, or JT, I don't know, sometimes I'll write JT of X. And the coarea formula tells us what the integral of the Jacobian looks like over a set. And okay, so we're in the case where we're mapping a higher dimensional space to a lower dimensional space. That's the case where the coarea formula applies. And it says that, let me state it in terms of test functions. So it says that if I integrate a test function against the Jacobian, then that's the same as integrating in the target space. And then you want to look for each point in the target space. So for example, if this was three dimensions and this was two dimensions, I would expect each point over here to correspond to a one-dimensional fiber on this side. And so I want to integrate over that fiber. The hm minus n measure of x. And there should be so far. Right, so that's the coarea formula. And if I choose my test function, so this should hold for every, again, let's say continuous test function on continuous bounded test function on n plus this time. And so if I choose psi x to be something like I want this measure here. So this is actually, this is integral of phi of e of x, f plus x, dh of x. And so I want to get something like that on the left-hand side, so I want to choose psi of x to be phi of t of x, f plus of x, divided by Jacobian t of x. And plug into this formula, and then you get that so the Jacobians cancel out. Right, so I get this t inverse y with respect to this lower dimensional measure. And so I have this thing here, and I'm always evaluating psi at t of x. So on t inverse y, that's going to be just phi of y, and I can pull it through. And if t is really rearranging f plus to give me f minus, then this formula here tells me that this should be equal to dy f minus y integrated over the lower dimensional space. And this identity is supposed to hold for all test functions phi. And so that basically means that the coefficient of phi, so maybe I'll write the phi out here. So the coefficient of phi, which is this thing, has to equal f minus. So therefore, so this is the nonlinear equation that t is trying to satisfy. And this is t inverse. And then the special case that m is equal to n in that case, t has a chance to be a diffeomorphism. Then this t inverse of y consists of a single point. And then we get f minus of y. And in that case, so dt and dt adjoint have the same determinant, so the square root becomes an absolute value determinant. So this would become f minus t of x is equal to f plus of x over absolute value of determinant of dt. And this is, this is getting, so there's another special case. And so, okay. This is going in the direction of a Monge-Ampère equation. We're not there yet because it's not a second order equation yet. We still have a very underdetermined system because we're looking for a mapping from Rm to Rn, or Rm to Rm in this case, and it's satisfying a single scalar equation. And so what, I haven't told you what the problem was yet. So what improves this underdetermined system, what allows us to select a solution, is we want to choose a mapping T that's optimal for a particular choice of cost. And maybe before I do that, let me give you an example. So the example is when m is equal to n is equal to 1. So then you define capital F to be the distribution, the cumulative distribution function of the probability measure mu. And similarly, F minus to be the cumulative distribution function of the probability measure mu minus. So these are both non-decreasing functions of X. And as long as as long as mu plus doesn't charge atoms. So the homework is to check that that if I look at F plus and compose with the inverse through F minus, satisfies for mu plus equals mu minus. So in one dimension, it's this very natural map that takes mu plus to mu minus, and basically it's an ordered preserving map on the real line. So if my mu plus looks like this, and my mu minus looks like that, I choose some x. What this mapping T that I've just defined does is it looks, f plus measures how much mass of mu plus is to the left of x, and f minus inverse finds the corresponding point that has the same area under mu minus to its left. And it defines that to be T. So it's usually called the Monge problem, is to given mu plus and mu minus and c, look at all maps t that push forward mu plus to mu minus, associate to each one of them a cost, weight that by mu plus, the amount of mass that's being transported from x to t under mu plus, integrate over m plus. Total cost, and Monge's problem was to try to minimize that cost over mappings to pushing forward mu plus to mu minus. And this infimum gives you a number, and if c was something like a, if m plus was equal to m minus and c was something like a distance on a metric space m plus equals m minus, then this would be some sort of measure of discrepancy between mu plus and mu minus. Call that number WC for the amount of work that it takes to move mu plus on to mu minus with respect to the cost C. And right. So this is the variational problem that I want to study. And being the minimizer in this thing is going to vastly restrict the mapping T that satisfies this very nonlinear integral differential equation that appears at the top of the board. So maybe I should put a box around that. So hopefully in good situations, the minimizer over here is going to pick off the unique solution to this problem for us. And so there's this. So what are some examples? So there are very classical examples. One example is that. Let me a few things. It's not always true that mappings exist pushing mu plus forward to mu minus. In particular, in you know, if mu plus was concentrated at a point and mu minus was not, then this set of T would be empty. And even when mappings do exist, it's not so obvious that the infimum is attained. The basic questions you can ask are, is it attained? If so, uniquely, can you characterize, et cetera. And there are two very classical situations when the answer to this question is well known. One of them is the one-dimensional situation. So if, let's say if the cost is twice continuously differentiable and has a fixed sign, or rather its mixed partials have a fixed sign, then this mapping here solves the problem. So this case is sometimes called the supermodular case, or the Spencer release case in the economics literature. And this is basically the situation in which the rewards in the problem are set up such that the husband with the greatest income marries the wife with the greatest income, and vice versa.
That condition is saying that the Hessian is positive everywhere.
Well, it's not really saying much about the Hessian, because the Hessian involves the pure partials of C with respect to X and the pure partials of C with respect to Y, and this is a statement about the mixed partials.
Oh, just the mixed,
okay. Right. Other questions? And, so it turns out that one nice generalization of this situation to higher dimensions is that you take C of x, y to the distance squared, or, well, okay, we say more about that. But, so you try to minimize distance squared. And then it turns out that the answer is sort of given by a theorem of Grenier from 25 years ago. So what's the analog of this condition here? Well, Grenier just assumed absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue, but we now know how to improve that a little bit. So if u plus vanishes on all, let's say, Lipschitz hypersurfaces, actually you don't need Lipschitz, you only need that it's given by the graph of the difference of convex functions. So in particular, as Grenier originally assumed, if it's absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue, then there exists a convex function again well there exists a convex function such that its derivative has the property that it pushes u plus forward to u minus. So this is, I guess, point one. And in some sense, this being, in one dimension, being the derivative of a convex function means you're an increasing map, or non-decreasing map. And that's exactly the analog. It's not so clear what it should mean in higher dimensions, but that's exactly the analog of being the composition of f minus inverse and f plus. So this pairing here gives a non-decreasing map of the line to itself. So in particular, this mapping would be gradient of convex function in one dimension, and it turns out that this is a natural analog in higher dimensions. And it also turns out that this is the only non-decreasing map that pushes forward mu plus to mu minus, and there's a parallel statement to that in higher dimensions. Only one such T arises as a convex gradient. T is unique. Mu plus almost everywhere. And T uniquely solves the optimization of the Saint-Thielemann problem for this positive. So far we don't know too much about T. It's the gradient of a convex function. So convex functions are locally Lipschitz, so it exists Lebesgue almost everywhere, and convex functions actually have two derivatives, Lebesgue almost everywhere by Alexandrov's theorem. So dt makes sense almost everywhere, and it turns out that this equation, determinant of dt, is given by the ratio of f plus at x to f minus at t of x holds almost everywhere. So in fact, and another nice thing happens, which is that the Hessian of a convex function is a non-negative definite matrix, so I can take away the absolute value signs. Almost everywhere. Let me say f plus almost everywhere. So this is an honest Monge-Ampere pair equation, and you can wonder, do I actually have a classical solution? And in general, the answer is no. You need to make much more restrictive assumptions on your mu plus and mu minus to hope to have a classical solution. You become smooth under very restrictive conditions. And then I really get a diffeomorphism on mu plus and mu minus. And basically, this was worked out by Delanoë in two dimensions and Caffarelli in higher dimensions, and also Verbaas. Still in the 90s.
Excuse me?
Yep.
I didn't understand. So you say that if mu plus vanishes on all Lipschitz hypersurfaces, but what? Why isn't that trivially? Oh, okay, never mind. For example,
Yeah. So this is a slightly weaker condition than this one.
Yeah.
And just as we didn't need mu plus to be absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue, we only needed to vanish at points.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Other questions? Great. And again, in equal dimensions, a parallel to this theory has been worked out for more general costs. And okay, so what should I say? It can't be completely general. So for example, So the original case that motivated Monge was the case where C was the Euclidean distance. And this is actually not a very nice class to work with from an analytic point of view. So there are sort of too many solutions. So even in one dimension, this is one solution for this problem. As you can, so this is this cost here maybe doesn't quite satisfy this condition, but it's a limit of things that do. So for example, as soon as p is bigger than 1, now this cost satisfies the spectrum release condition. And then you have the same solution for every p strictly larger than 1. And so taking the limit as p goes to 1, you still have a solution for p equals 1. But there are lots of others. And so for example, examples, you want to take a row of books and move them one place to the left on your shelf. Either you move each book one place to the left, that's the solution given up there, or you take the right, you leave all but one book in place and you take the rightmost book and bring it around to the left hand side, and the cost is either n times 1 or 1 times n, depending on where n is the number of books. And so so there's two solutions. So there's a parallel theory, but no uniqueness. And actually, you can do things for p less than 1 as well. And so this becomes a harder case. And so Even regularity results have been worked out for some of these more general cases by Monge, starting with Montreux and Wong about 10 years ago. And oh, let me remind you of one of the nice applications. So I apologize to there are some experts in the room, and I apologize to the experts. I'm doing things that are pretty well known, at least for today and tomorrow. But there's a nice application. This theorem here in connection with isoparametric take inequalities. So. So what's the idea? The idea is that when you have an optimal mapping, it you can use it to localize information about the relationship between mu plus and mu minus. And when you have localized information, you can use algebraic identities to deduce global information about mu plus and mu minus. And so one example is an application to the proof of the isoparametric inequality. So suppose that I have two sets, m plus in Rm. I'm in the case m equals n again. And the unit ball, I'll take m minus to the unit ball. And I'm going to assume that they have the same volume. And so in that case, the isoparametric inequality implies that the Hausdorff m minus 1 dimensional measure of the boundary of m plus should be bigger than the Hausdorff m minus 1 dimensional measure of the boundary of m minus, because the ball is supposed to have the least area among all sets of its size, least surface area. And so what's the picture? The picture is that m plus maybe looks like this. M minus is a ball with the same volume. And Brenier's theorem over here tells us that we can find, if we take uniform measures on these two sets. Normalized by mass of the ball, volume of the ball. Then what Brenier's theorem is telling us that we can find a volume-preserving map, T, between these two sets, which moreover has the form of being the gradient of a convex function. And so it satisfies this equation here, at least in M plus, and the right-hand side is 1 over 1, because the gradient of U is taking values in mu minus at least almost everywhere. So T pushing forward mu plus to mu minus implies that 1 is equal to the determinant of the derivative of T, which is the Hessian in U on M plus. It's obeyed almost everywhere on M plus. And a convex function, its Hessian is non-negative definite, so this is a product of n non-negative eigenvalues, and so the domination of geometric by the arithmetic mean tells you that that's less than the mean of the n eigenvalues, which is 1 over n, the trace of the Hessian. And so basically I use this map to localize global information about m plus and m minus, and I have applied this, you know, algebraic identity to the Hessian of u at each point x, and now I just integrate. So you integrate 1 over m plus with respect to the ambient measure, and you get volume of m plus. And that's going to be less than or equal to 1 over n. Another name for the trace of the Hessian is the Laplacian. So this is the Laplacian of u in the almost everywhere sense. But actually, convex functions, their Laplacians can have singular parts, but the singular parts are always positive definite. So this is 1 over n Laplacian in the distributional sense of u. And then I can integrate by parts, and this becomes a boundary integral. And a gradient u dotted with the outer normal with respect to surface measure. And the gradient of u is always taking values in the unit ball. And so this, as in Javier's talk this morning, this is at most 1. And so the right-hand side is at most 1 over n times the perimeter of m plus. And on the other hand, in the case where m plus is also equal to the unit ball, the mapping T is going to be the identity map. And so its Hessian is going to be the identity matrix. And the product of 1s is equal to the average of 1s. So I'll have equality here. And so it happens that the unit normal, when m plus is the ball, the unit normal at x on the boundary is equal to x. And so I also have equality here. And so I have equality throughout in the case of the unit ball. And so this is equal to m minus, which is 1 over n, the perimeter of the unit ball. And that's the exact isometric.
So U was playing the role of a calibration.
Maybe DU is. I haven't thought about that. There's not really a minimal surface here that I know of. Well, okay, there are minimal surfaces here, but I don't think you see them yet. And I wasn't really. It turns out that there are quotes in quite unexpected connections between optimal transportation and geometric measure theory that you can read about in my notes a little bit, but for example, in section 6 of my notes with Guillen, and I wasn't so much planning to talk about them this week. They don't have to do with minimal hypersurfaces, though. They mostly have to do with minimizing objects of dimension n into n dimensions. So the graph T, if I think of the graph of T, it's a subset of our In the case where I have n equals n, it's a subset of R2n. Uh-huh. And that has some minimizing property as an n-dimensional subset of R2n.
But what he meant is that these arguments are calibration.
Is it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. You find like a subsolution and.
Okay, so it turns out the main technical tool for making progress with the transportation problem is this kind of famous duality due to Kantorovich. So let me tell you a little bit about that. So, and so maybe I motivated the following way. So it also turns out that optimal transportation is very closely connected to what they call the stable marriage problem in economics. And the stable marriage problem can be set in different economic frameworks. But here's a simple one. So N men and women, and men and women. And if what's called the transferable utility case, let's say stable marriage problem. So there are two extreme cases that economists work on of this problem. And one of them is is what's called transferable utility, and that's the case where I may prefer marrying woman A to woman B. However, if woman B agrees to do all the housework and raise the children and woman A doesn't, then I may prefer to marry woman B rather than woman A. So that's the so-called transferable utility case, and it's the case where you can pass surplus back and forth between members in the partnership. And the non-transferable utility case is the case where I'm stuck with, I can't make any negotiation with my potential spouse that will affect how much I like or don't like her. And actually, the non-transferable utility case is used in, it's applied in the case of medical students graduating from medical school who want to find a place, a residency program. And so what happens is that all of the medical students, they apply to residency programs they're interested in, and then residency programs interview the students that they're interested in, and after the interviews happen, the residency programs send a ranked list to the National Medical Residency Matching Program of which students they would like to hire, and the residents also send ranked lists of which programs they would like to be residents in, and then I think all this information goes to a company in Boston, and the company in Boston tries to pair up students with residency programs, and the goal of the company is that after the pairing is done, the solution should be stable in the sense that you can't find a student and a residency program who would both prefer to divorce their partners and marry each other. So that would be an unstable match. And so that, it turns out, in the National Medical Residency Matching Program, it's a non-transferable utility match in the sense that the residency programs have fixed parameters, like, for example, the amount that they want to pay the resident, and they're not allowed to adjust those parameters. They're not allowed to say, well, if we get that resident, we're going to pay him twice as much as if we get this one. But the case that's relevant to optimal transportation is the transferable utility case. And actually, both cases, both these extreme cases, non-transferable utility and transferable utility, were worked out, the existence of a stable match was worked out around 1970 by David Gale and different co-authors. So by Gale and Shapley, in the case of transferable utility, they showed it was equivalent to an optimization problem of the sort that we've written down. And I don't remember who the co-author was on the non-transferable case, but basically they had an algorithm that allowed you to show that in the non-transferable utility case, you can arrive at a stable matching, and the algorithm's sort of interesting. It's called deferred acceptance, and it's basically a dating algorithm. So all the men make proposals to all the women. Each man proposes to his first choice woman. Then each woman looks at the proposal she receives and rejects all but her favorite proposal. And then all the rejected men in round two now make proposals to their second choice woman. And after round two, all the women look at the proposals that they've, either the one they held on to or the new ones that they've received, and they reject all but their favorite one. And then you iterate this. You go on to round three, and after n rounds, you've arrived at a solution that's stable in the sense just described. And actually, it turns out that there's more than one stable solution. And some of the solutions are better from the women's point of view, and some of the solutions are better from the men's point of view. And it turns out that the one that we just described, where the men do the proposing, is the one that's most favorable from the point of view of the men. And if we turned the tables and had the women do the proposing, we would arrive at the solution that was most favorable from the point of view of the women. And it turns out there's a whole lattice of solutions. So for any two solutions, there's one that's that dominates both from the point of view of the men and one that dominates both from the point of view of the women. Okay. So what's the stable marriage problem? So man X marrying woman Y with transferable utility. Actually, I should do this the other way. Man Y marrying woman X produces a surplus S of XY. And that's and then they can, then the two of them, if they marry each other, they can negotiate on who gets to keep what share of the surplus. And so S of XY can be then divided into U of XY plus V of Y. So this is the woman's share. And this is the man's share. And so what the way marriages are represented is we're going to use a matrix. So we'll have a marriage matrix gamma xy, where gamma is between 0 and 1. And if x is married to y, gamma will equal 1. If x is not married to y, gamma will equal 0. And so basically, we're going to operate under a monogamy constraint. That the sum of the gamma xy's, if I sum over women, is going to equal 1. And if I sum over men, sorry, I probably said the words backwards, it's also going to equal 1. So basically, that says that each row of gamma has, the non-zero entries in a given row of gamma sum to 1, and the non-zero entries in a given column of gamma sum to 1. And what are we looking for? We're looking for a pair of utilities, U of X and V of Y, so stability. So we see U and V and gamma, such that what happens? So stability says that U of X plus VY should be at least S of XY for every X and Y. And gamma should satisfy these population balance constraints, or what's called these mass balance. And then U and V should be related. So basically, why is this stability? So if this inequality went the other way, man X and woman Y would be getting less between the two of them than they could get if they married each other. And so if this inequality was less than, strictly less than, they would want to leave their partners, marry each other, and they could both be better off. So the utilities should be large enough that nobody has any incentive to leave their partner. No pair, both have an incentive to leave their partner and marry each other. That's the stability constraint one. And on the other hand, they should be attainable. If I try to give the men and the women both too much, then I won't be able to find any way to pair them such that they can get this amount of utility. And so that's what you might call the budget constraint. So the condition that relates U and V to gamma is that equality holds. If gamma is positive. So for any marriage that actually happens, that marriage has to generate enough surplus that the man can get what he wants and the woman can get what she wants out of it. So let's say this is condition 2. And so in the stable marriage problem, we're looking for U, V, and gamma satisfying U and V satisfying condition one, gamma satisfying conditions three, and the relation between them being condition two, which is sort of a complementary slackness condition, wherever so gamma was not negative, and wherever it's strictly positive, it should equal the surplus generated should equal the utilities derived. And so what did Gale and Shapley show about this problem? Okay, so they showed that so if I have one and three together, that implies that I can multiply this equation one by gamma xy, since gamma is non-negative, without changing the inequality. And then I can sum over xy. So let's say u of x plus v1 gamma xy is bigger than sxy. I'm now going to sum over x and y. And I can use the column and row constraints on gamma to see that on the left-hand side, I can do the sum over y and get the sum of ux. And using the row constraint, I can do the sum over x and get the sum of vy. And that will be bigger than this sum over x and y and sx gamma y. And so since this is less than that, for all gamma satisfying 1, I might as well maximize over gamma satisfying 1. And since this is bigger than this for all u and v satisfying, for all gamma satisfying 3. And since this is bigger than this for all u and v satisfying 1, I might as well minimize over all u and v such that 1 hold. And if 2 is to hold, if 2 holds, then I will actually have equality here. And so I will have equality here. And so this is equality if and only if 2 holds. And so the idea of, so finally I think I have it right. So this is probably Shapley and Shubik. And this is around 1970, and the non-transferable utility case with Gale and Shapley also around 1970, and they described the algorithm, the deferred acceptance, the dating algorithm that I described. So the reason I couldn't think of Gale's co-author on this paper was that Gale wasn't an author on this paper. So they understood that actually, this is a special case of linear programming duality, so equality actually always holds. So this is a linear program because I'm maximizing a linear function of gamma over a convex set, 3. And this is another linear program because I'm minimizing a linear function of u and v over the convex set of u and v satisfying 1. And so equality holds this special case of linear programming duality. And so as long as the maximizer and the minimizer are attained, then you have a solution, then you have a stable variance, stable one matching. So it turns out that exactly the same scheme can be applied to our problem, the Monge problem. And this was done by Kantorovich. So Kantorovich. So you given probability measures, for all probability measures on their respective spaces, instead of looking for a mapping T from M plus to M minus, which pushes forward mu plus to mu minus, he looks for a joint measure on the product space. That's like our matrix gamma over here. And it should have the property that if you project all of its mass onto mu plus, you see mu plus, M plus, you see mu plus, and if you project all of it, so the picture is like this. So I have M plus with measure mu plus, and M minus with measure mu minus, and now I'm looking for a joint measure on the product such that if I project the mass down here, I see this guy, and if I project the mass over there, I see that guy. So one way of writing this is if you adopt the convention that pi plus is the first coordinate of the two guys, pi minus is the second coordinate on the product space here, I want pi plus or minus to push forward gamma to mu plus or minus. Those are the marginal constraints. So I want some gamma in set capital gamma, which obviously depends on mu and mu. So sometimes I'll write that as gamma mu, or mu plus mu minus rather. And associated, now this is a convex set. Non-negative measures and these constraints here are affine linear constraints. And then I want to minimize cost associated with gamma will be basically the cost of transporting from x to y weighted by the amount of mass that you're going to transport from x to y. And so I'm going to try to, right, so Cantor Rose's problem is to compute the infimum of C gamma over all gamma in this space here. And this is a much nicer problem than Monge's. It's strongly analogous to this maximization on the right-hand side upstairs. That's the discrete case. It's a nicer problem because now I'm working on a convex set. It lives in some, measures live in the dual space to continuous bounded functions if, for example, M plus and M minus are compact Hausdorff spaces. And so as the dual space, such the space of probability measures the mass one inherits compactness from the Banach-Alohu theorem. And so as long as this is non-empty and maybe C is continuous, the minimum will be attained. And gamma is always non-empty because a particular example is product measure. And so we're already in a better situation than in Monge's problem because we know that we're minimizing over some non-empty class of things. And as long as C is continuous and these are compact Hausdorff spaces, the minimum will be attained. And so that's one thing that Ken Roach did. And the other thing that he did was he showed that there was an analogous, at least in some restricted case, where mu plus and minus were a metric space and C was the metrical distance. He showed that there was an analogous maximization problem strongly analogous to the thing that appears on the left. So it's going to involve a constraint like this. And so this is supposed to be equal to the supremum over all u and v. So probably now at this point, okay, good. I'm almost out of time. That's perfect. It's the supremum of integral u du plus integral v du minus, where the u plus and the v minus are constrained to be less than c. So this is u and v, and let's say that c, where this space here is pretty much analogous to that one. So let C is the set of U that are in L1 to U plus and V in L1 to U minus such that C is bigger than or equal to UX plus UI. And So what we'll want to show, what will happen tomorrow morning is that we'll want to show that the supremum is actually attained, and then we can characterize optimizers on either side of this equation in terms of optimizers on the other side. So we can kind of give necessary and sufficient conditions for gamma to be optimal or minimal, or for U and V to be maximal. And that's going to help us turn the integral differential equation that we saw earlier in the hour into something a little bit more tractable. And let me mention one example. Let me close by mentioning an example, which is kind of important. So it's important to understand that Kantorovich's problem is really a relaxation of Monge's problem. And so the example is that if T pushes forward mu plus to mu minus, then gamma T, which is defined by pushing forward mu plus through the mapping identity cross T, belongs to gamma. So if I have a Monge competitor, it leads to a Kantorovich competitor, and moreover, the Monge cost of T is equal to the Kantorovich cost of gamma T. So this is something to check for. All right, thank you very much.
We have a break now. You can ask Robert if you have